Okay, so hello everyone. Welcome to AVLSI lecture number 17, part 1. Today we are going to start with a new topic, that is a cascode amplifier stage. So basically, we all know from a lower semester theory that cascode is a kind of a multi-stage amplifier. Correct? We all have heard of cascade amplifier, but a cascode amplifier is different than a cascade amplifier, right? So this is one arrangement of a cascode amplifier shown in front of you. We have M1 transistor, right? Its gate terminal, we have been applied an input. So your microphone signal will act as an input. V1 is the bias voltage applied to the gate of M1 so that your M1 remains in saturation, right? And the output of M1, that is the drain terminal of M1, is connected to the source of M2. So M2 receives input from the output of M1, right? And at the gate of M2, we have applied a bias voltage again to make sure that M2 remains in saturation. And M2 is not your load, okay? M2 is not your load, but basically your RD is the load, correct? So whatever current is passing through M2, it's then passing through RD, and then it produces the output Vout, okay? And this load RD can be any type of load. Now we have seen common source amplifier with different loads, right? So this load RD can be a common source load or a current source load. It can be a resistor. It can be a diode load, or it also can be a triode load. Fine. Here, basically your M2 transistor is your cascode stage, or we can call it as a current buffer. Now, why it is called, how it is a current buffer, we will soon, analyze this further. But since they are connected in this fashion, what happens is your M1 generates a small signal drain current because of the small signal input, right? And that drain current is proportional to the small signal input Vin. So what happens is this current is directly flowing into the M2, right? And M2 will direct this small signal drain current to RD. So M2 will receive the current at its input terminal, that is the source terminal, and it will direct it to the resistor RD. So also one more requirement is there, that M1 and M2 should be in saturation. And can you tell me, out of M1 and M2, which transistor suffers from body effect? Body effect means VSB is not equal to zero. The source voltage and body voltage are not equal. So can you tell me which transistor? We can go to simplified form over here. Out of M1 and M2, which transistor is suffering from body effect? Anyone? It's M2 transistor. M1 transistor doesn't suffer from body effect because its source terminal is connected to ground, and body is also connected to ground for an integrated circuit. And for M2 transistor, it's not the case. The source terminal is not at ground, right? And so your M2 is your CG stage, and your common gate stage, and M1 is acting as a common source stage. So this topology, the cascade of your common source stage and your common gate stage, is called as your cascode topology. Fine. Now there is one thing which I want to share, that you're the same current, M1 and M2 carries the equal bias and the signal current. Now you will say, what is a bias current and a signal current? See, even if you don't apply any signal, AC input signal, still there is a current flow. Correct, na? Because that is to bias the transistor in the proper operating region. Now there is a signal current. Now, when does the signal current will, it will be riding over the biasing current, but signal current will be present only when your external signal is applied, input signal. Let's say you have a microphone and you speak into the microphone. So until you speak into the microphone, there won't be any signal, current signal, right? So that's why we say M1 and M2 are connected in series, and they will carry the same bias and the signal current. So this configuration over here, which you see in front of your screens, is called as telescopic cascode. It is called as, there is a word over here, telescopic cascode. Just remember the name. This is the same cascode. It is called as a telescopic cascode. Just the name given. Okay. Now, Is there an advantage of adding? Because see, if you compare this with a common source amplifier, what is the addition? Only M2 transistor is the addition. If you remove M2 transistor and connect this resistor directly to the drain terminal of M1, this becomes a common source amplifier. So there will be some advantage of connecting this M2 transistor. Now, okay, that M2 transistor is nothing but acting as a current buffer. Now, all of you know what is a voltage buffer, right? What is a voltage buffer? Which provides a voltage gain of 1. So what will be a current buffer? Anyone? Correspondingly, what will be a current buffer?
Providing the current as 1.
Yes. So that means what? Yes, current buffer is exactly that. Current buffer will have a current gain of 1. That means whatever current is coming out of M1, same current is flowing into the resistor RD. So that is the job of M2. So what is the advantage of a current buffer? So first of all, any changes in the output terminal won't affect the input voltage. We'll come back to it. You know why the changes in the output will affect the input? We'll come back to this point. Also, your M2 current buffer provides the same current at its drain terminal and its source terminal. Okay, that means if you have a source terminal of M2 and drain terminal of M2, it will provide the same current because the current gain is unity. And this feature will provide an extra input shielding in a cascode stage. Okay, now what do you mean by input shielding? It will be clear to you in some time. But these are the two advantages, that any changes in the output terminal V out won't affect the input. We'll come back to this point. And secondly, your M2 current buffer provides same current at its drain terminal and at its source terminal. That means the current gain is unity. And this feature will provide an extra input shielding in the cascode stage. So let us try to understand how. So let me explain it this way. Let me also keep a circuit ready for a reference, so that any time you want to have a look at it, you can have a look at it. Okay. I guess both the circuit as well as the explanation is visible to you. Yeah. Let me also keep it this way, so that both the screens are visible to you now. Okay, fine. So I can revolve around this. Now let us explain in short why that first point, why that output changes will affect the input, right? So let us begin. So we all know M1 transistor is working in the saturation region. So the drain current ID1 will be given by half mu n C ox W over L into VGS minus VTH the whole square, assuming that lambda is, zero. We are ignoring the channel and modulation. Now, what is VGS for M1? VGS is nothing but, we also have V1 that is there. V1 is the bias voltage, but actually VGS is nothing but your Vin only, correct? So that means if my Vin changes, my ID1 changes, correct? But ID1 should change only due to, ID1 should change due to Vin only, right? It should not change due to any other thing. So what will M2 do? M2 will keep the ID1 steady. It's a voltage, it's a current buffer, right? So that means M1 and M2 are in series. So ID1 will be equal to ID2. And what is ID2 can be written as? ID2 can be written as VDD minus Vout divided by RD. Any doubt over here? Very simple it is. ID2 will be given by VDD minus Vout upon RD. So that means if RD changes, it will affect ID2, right? And it's a current source load, right? So it can be replaced by another load also, diode load or triode load. And due to that, the current might change, right? So that means the resistance might change. So what will happen is, if RD changes, that means what? My ID2 will change. And once it affects ID2, it will also affect ID1. And if ID1 gets affected, my Vin gets affected, which is undesirable. Okay, so this should not happen. So what happens is that M2 transistor will act as a shield to the changes in ID2, right? So that means even if ID2 changes due to any reason whatsoever, even though the ID2, the drain current ID2 changes due to whatever reason whatsoever, for example, ID2 can change due to supply voltage, because VDD can also change, then ID2 also depends upon your mobility, process variations, W by L of transistors, right? So if ID2 changes, your MT2, what it will do is, M2, what it will do, it will act as a shield. Okay, that means it will not affect ID1 at all. It will keep ID2 steady. So what really happens is M2 will act as a shield to the changes in ID2. That means the changes in ID2 are not reflected in ID1. Okay, and that is the concept of input shielding. In short, it's a very simple concept. Let's say you're, because of change in the input voltage or microphone signal, you're talking to into a microphone, you have a small variation in the input. Those variations are converted into current variations at the output of M1. And those variations are fed to the transistor M2. And those are being taken out at the output. So let's say if ID2 only changes, if ID2 changes, everything will change. So what M2 will do? M2 will try to keep the current at its drain terminal and source terminal steady. So even if there are any changes in ID2, it won't affect ID1 at all. Because if ID1 changes, your Vin changes. And that will disturb the gain and all the operation, right? So these are the this is what in short input shielding is. Now, after I think 2 or 3 sessions, we will discuss in detail about input shielding, and we will derive some results also on that. Okay, so this is conceptually the meaning of input shielding, meaning any changes in the output are shielded by M2 transistor and they are not being reflected at the input side. So M2 transistor act as a shield between the output and the M1 transistor and the input. Okay, now what are the advantages of cascode amplifier? There should be some advantages over the single stage amplifier, right? Single stage common source amplifier. So first example is input shielding. Second is increase in gain. You get a higher gain using a cascode amplifier. Then you have a very high input impedance. Okay, and also you have a high output impedance. So these are the advantages of a cascode amplifier. Any doubts, anyone, or anything you want to ask in this? Cascode amplifier.
Uh-huh.
Okay, yeah, thank you. So let's move on to the next one. Now what we have to do is, we know the standard procedure, we have to derive the small signal voltage gain, its input impedance, output impedance, and then we have to solve a numerical based on this. So same procedure we will be following here, and we will be changing the load from resistive load to a different kind of a load, like for example current source load or diode connected load. So because we don't prefer using resistors in integrated circuit, so we have to replace this resistor RD also. But for elementary circuit, this is the starting point. Okay, so this is your cascode stage, or we can also call this as a telescopic cascode. Now let's move on to the second one. So now we will be analyzing with respect to small signal analysis of cascode amplifier. So here is my amplifier. I have redrawn it over here. I have marked the terminals because I have to perform small signal analysis to find the voltage gain, output impedance, and so on and so forth. So I have to draw the small signal model of the circuit, correct? So hence I have written gate 1, drain 1, source 1, gate 2, drain 2, source 2. Okay, now let me draw, I have to find the intrinsic gain of the cascode. Now anyone know what do you mean by intrinsic gain of cascode? Intrinsic gain, anyone understands? Do you have an idea? What do you mean by it? Intrinsic gain.
It's GM, right?
No. Intrinsic gain means gain of the transistor itself. So basically, for a MOSFET, for a single MOSFET, your intrinsic gain will be GM into RO, not GM. GM is the transconductance. GM into small RO. Without connecting any load. Okay, meaning if we say we have to find the intrinsic gain of Cascode, it means we have to disconnect the load and find the gain of the circuit by disconnecting the load. That is what you mean by finding the intrinsic gain of Cascode amplifier. So intrinsic gain of Cascode means with M1 and M2 and without the load RD. Do you understand? Only with a MOSFET, no load connected. So we will find that gain, and then if we want to find the final gain, we will, you know, whatever gain we found out over here, and then we'll multiply it with RD, that's it. So that will become my overall gain. Fine, are you all following? So that is the approach which we'll be adopting today. So to your left hand side, we have the PDF, which is the circuit diagram given, right? So with looking at this, we have to draw the small signal model of your Cascode. Okay, without the load. So let us begin. Yeah. So let us start. How I have done it, I'll explain one by one. So look at this diagram over here. Gate, concentrate on M1 transistor. We know how M1 transistor is not suffering from body effect. So GMB will not come. And we are considering channel and modulation parameters. So RO1 will come. So gate terminal, gate 1, we have Vin connected. Between gate and source, we have VGS1. Source terminal is grounded. Between the drain and source, I mean D1 and S1, we have GM1, VGS1, RO1. You know why we are writing 1, because it's for M1 transistor. Now, this drain 1 is connected to the source 2 of another NMOS transistor, right? So this is going to the source 2. Now, gate terminal of source 2 is grounded. Why? Because VB is a DC bias voltage. VB is the DC bias voltage. That's why we ground it. And we know M2 is suffering from body effect, right? Its VSB is non-zero. So GMB term will come for your M2 transistor. And from the drain terminal, we have RD, which is going to the ground, and the output also coming across the drain terminal. So between the drain and source, we have GM2, VGS2, RO2, and GMB2, VBS2. And then we have Vout, okay? And then we have to club them together, and the entire circuit looks something like this. The small signal model looks like this. Fine. So if I expand it right now, yeah. So your to find the intrinsic gain of Cascode, this is the small signal model of a Cascode stage. I mean, we are not connecting RD, so RD won't be there because we are only concentrating on the intrinsic gain, right? So this is the small signal model of the Cascode stage, excluding load. Fine. So what we are trying to do over here is now this is the small signal model, right? Now what do we do is we are considering this much circuit. This is our circuit, right? We have M1 and M2. This is M2 actually. And we are finding the output resistance looking into the drain terminal. What are we doing? We are finding the output resistance R out looking into the drain terminal. And what's the procedure to calculate the output impedance? Right? We add an external test source. We put the entire small signal model inside the box. And we make Vin equal to 0. So we have made Vin equal to 0. As you can see, Vin is equal to 0. Entire circuit is put inside the box. And we apply a test source at the output. I mean, at the output terminal. That is, in this case, the drain 2 terminal. So this is my drain 2 terminal. I have connected an external supply Vx. And I measured a current Ix. So R out will be Vx upon Ix. Fine. So yeah, let us begin. So over here, let us start. We have to find the expression of Vx upon Ix. Now we know that the gate terminal, gate 1 terminal, and the source 1 terminal of my MOSFET over here for M1 transistor is 0. That means GM1, VGS1 current source will be 0 because VGS1 is 0, correct? So whenever a current source is equal to 0, it is represented by an open circuit. Are you following? Yeah. Gate voltage is 0, gate 1 voltage is 0, source 1 is 0. So VGS1 will be 0. That means GM1, VGS1 source, current source will be 0. And that means your current source will be represented by an open circuit. So the same circuit reduces as follows. Here it is. That entire thing has disappeared now. So you have this much circuit only. For this, we have to derive a relation between Vx upon Ix. Okay, so let us continue further over here. Now, what is VGS2? VGS2 voltage is coming across this, right? It's parallel, right? So VGS2, I can say that it is IX into RO1. Now, why this is IX? See, this IX is current entering the drain terminal, drain to terminal. So the current leaving the, entering the source to terminal also will be same or should be same, right? So therefore, we can say that your VGS2, which is nothing but your, minus VGS2. Here it will come minus because here it is minus and other terminal is ground. So here will come minus VGS2. VGS2 will be equal to minus of IX into RO1. Okay. So this is our first equation. And what will be VBS2? VB2 is zero because the body terminal is grounded. And VS2 is nothing but your minus of VGS2. Correct? VS2 is nothing but your minus of VGS2. And we know what is VGS2. Minus IX into RO1. Fine. So we got the value of VGS2 and VBS2. And now we will apply a normal KVL. So a normal KVL to the, to the outer loop. That is this. To the inner loop of drain to source. Over here. From here to here. Okay. From the VX to the ground. Like this ground. So VX will be given by RO2 into, we have done this before, IX minus GM2 VGS2 minus GMB2 VBS2, right? So this is the resistance into the current, because there are, if I say current flowing through RO2, there are three currents actually. IX is there, which is leaving, and your GM2 VGS2 and GMB2 VBS2 are also the two other current sources, right? And VX will be equal to RO2 into this term plus IX into RO1, okay? Because we are going on to the other side, right? Or if we want to write it strictly, we can write VX minus RO2 into IX minus GM2 VGS2 minus GMB2 VBS2 minus IX RO1 is equal to zero. So if we take it on that side, this will become plus both the things. And now we know that VGS2 is nothing but minus IX into RO2. So this will become plus GM2 into IX into RO1, right? RO1. And VBS2 will be minus IX into RO1. So this again will become GMB2 IX into RO1. So now we have all the terms of VX and IX only. So we'll isolate them together. And we will put VX on one side and IX terms on the other side. So finally, VX upon RX will be equal to R out, which is R out, right? R out will be equal to RO2 into 1 plus GM2 plus GMB2 into RO1, the whole bracket close, plus RO1. Okay. Now you see how high is this value. You know, RO1 value, it's in kilo ohms. So this is RO2 into, we have this term. So this R out will be very, very high. And is it a good thing? Yes, it's a good thing, because if I have a circuit whose output impedance is very, very high, I can make it use as a, current source, right? Current source output impedance would be extremely high. So I can use cascode stage as a current source. That will be a very good advantage. Fine. Everyone understood how we got this expression of R out? So this is a very important expression. If you are noting it down, please note down in your books. R out is equal to RO2 into 1 plus GM2 plus GMB2 into RO1, bracket close, plus RO1. Okay? The same expression you can write it as follows. So this is what we are doing. We are making Vin equal to 0 and we are finding R out into this network. This is my cascode, right? And this is my R out expression, which we have just now derived. So if we assume GM into RO product is very much greater than dumb, then we have R out is approximately equal to GM2 plus GMB2 into RO1 into RO2. So that means your M2 transistor will boost the output impedance of M1 by a factor of GM2 plus GMB2 into RO2. Because what was the output impedance just of M1? Output impedance of M1 was just RO1, if you remember. If you look directly into the drain terminal of M1, we just get RO1. But if I add as a cascode, I mean M2 is added as a cascode. So what it will do is it will boost the output impedance of M1 by this factor. So you have additional factor GM2 plus GMB2 into RO2 coming into picture. So that will increase your output impedance of your circuit to a tremendously higher value. Are you all following? Yeah. So now we have determined Rout. Next is what? We'll determine the transconductance of your amplifier. Now we know for a CS amplifier, what is the transconductance given by? GM1. Correct. And in our case also, our Vin is applied to M1 transistor. And M1 transistor is my CS amplifier. Correct. So what's the GM for that? GM is given by capital GM is of the amplifier. Remember. And small GM is of the device. So in this case, since my M1 transistor is acting as a common source amplifier and my Vin is equal to VGS, capital GM is given by Iout divided by Vin. And what is the Iout for M1 transistor? It's ID. And what is the Vin for the M1 transistor? VGS. So what will be capital GM? Capital GM will be ID upon VGS, which is nothing but GM1, small GM1. Are you following this? So your transconductance of the amplifier is same as your transconductance of your device M for this circuit. Okay. And we have studied a lemma that your voltage gain will be equal to minus of capital GM into Rout. I think we have studied that in the source degeneration common source amplifier lemma. That is, if it is a linear network, then we can represent in this form, voltage gain minus capital GM into Rout. Fine. So your intrinsic gain of your cascode stage is given by this formula. Your GM1 minus GM1 into Rout. This entire expression is capital Rout. Okay. So kindly note down, and we know that this is very high. This is extremely high. If you compare this with a common source amplifier, what was the gain of a common source amplifier? Anyone remembers? Very elementary gain. Minus GM1 into RLD. Correct, na? Common source amplifier. But yes. In this case, you see this value, Rout value, it's very, very high compared to RLD. That's why we say for a cascode amplifier, the gain is pretty high. Okay, so please note down the formula. You can take a print screen. This is the feature of or advantage of your common source, your cascode stage. Okay, so I hope you have noted down the formula for your voltage gain, intrinsic gain of your cascode stage will be given by minus GM1 into Rout, capital Rout, which is very, very high value. Now, let us compare this. That is what I was saying. Intrinsic gain of MOSFET is given by minus GM into RO for a single MOSFET. And by adding it as a cascode stage, you see how much it is increasing. So your intrinsic gain of your cascode is much, much larger as compared to the single MOSFET. Okay. Cascode stage means without connecting any load, RD. If you just, calculate the gain of this cascode stage, it's given by this formula, 17.2.4. Okay, I hope that you will note it down. Okay. Fine. So, yeah. So, let's revise what we have done so far. So, we have started with, cascode amplifier, and we have started looking at its small signal analysis. So we said that first we will find the intrinsic gain of cascode stage, right? And that is without the load RD. So for that we calculated Rout, using the technique which we know already. So Rout will be actually Vx upon Ix. So somehow we managed to got the expression for Rout, and Rout was very, very high for a cascode stage. Then we calculated capital GM, which was coming out to be small GM1 for M1 transistor. And then finally, we have used the lemma and we have written the expression for gain AV, which is minus capital GM into R out. So this is the intrinsic gain of your cascode stage. And we have compared at the last the intrinsic gain of your cascode and your MOSFET. And definitely your cascode is having a much, much higher intrinsic gain compared to a single MOSFET. Any doubts anyone in this? So next we will start with the numerical.